Gregorian brings us great joy and happiness. We worship this morning in the services printed in your bulletin. We begin with hymn 351, The Rise of the Last Estates.
Trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ.
of all servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. For all that we need in life, and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. For the steadfast assurance of nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Thank you.
showed me the river of the water of life, which was as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and the Lamb. In the middle of the city street and on each side of the river was a tree of life that yielded 12 kinds of fruit. The tree yields its fruit every month, and its leaves are for the healing of the nations. There will no longer be any curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be in the city. His servants will worship God. They will see his face. His name will be on their foreheads. There will no longer be any night or need for a lamplight or sunlight, because the Lord God will shine on them, and they will reign forever and ever. The angel said to me, "These words are faithful and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place." The word of the Lord. Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Rise and hear the Holy Gospel. Our gospel lesson is recorded for us in Mark chapter 8, beginning at verse 31. Jesus, again and again, told his disciples what was going to happen to him. It was a shocking truth. At the same time, this was nothing new. From the time of mankind's fall in the garden and throughout the Old Testament period, God had prepared his people to see their Savior as a sacrifice, one who would have to give himself innocently for the guilt of mankind. So, looking back and looking forward, we see that the Lord is always faithful to that plan. Jesus wanted his disciples to be prepared so that they would understand what they would witness in a short time. Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the experts of the law, be killed, and in 3 days rise again. He was speaking plainly to them. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But after turning around and looking at his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You do not have your mind set on the things of God, but on the things of men." He called the crowd and his disciples together and said to them, "If anyone wants to follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. After all, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? In fact, whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
rather we'll consider today from Revelation 22. So do you, are you thinking about next winter yet? You're nuts. We've had enough of this. We're getting ready for spring, right? It's time to plant. Time to get ready for something that is alive and green and springing up. You know, some veggies, some fruit, some pretty flowers, all that stuff that we look for in the spring. We take some seeds, we put them in the ground, and a few months later, we see the harvest, we see the blossoms. For a few months, we see the fruit on the trees. But of course, by the time fall comes along, or sometimes it might be a little bit longer, maybe it's a couple years. Whatever we plant ends up dying, and that's it. It's gone. Kind of sad that in a certain sense, we see the same thing happen with human life. A child is born, and we celebrate that new human life. But we all know how it's going to end, whether it's in 100 days or 100 years. The child is set forth on the path of the grave. It's very sad. When we look at the books of Genesis and Revelation, we're seeing the beginning and end, not only the beginning and the end of the Bible, but the story of the beginning and the end. We're quick to associate Genesis with beginnings, which makes sense because that's the name of the book. It is a book about beginnings. The truth is that what starts in Genesis, however, ends pretty quickly. We start with God's amazing creation. Everything is beautiful and perfect. Everything is done to scale and perfection. There is harmony and life every place. But by the third chapter of Genesis, it's over. Man has sinned and has brought destruction into the world. We find the end in Genesis chapter 3. The end of perfection, the end of joy, the end of harmony, most importantly, the end of life. God's design, his power, got it all off to a great start, but we human beings, we quickly brought it to an end through our disobedience, through our rebellion. We can look at the book of Genesis and we can see that beautiful garden, but it was a garden that was now separated from man. He could not enter it anymore, and eventually it would be destroyed in a few hundred years in the great flood. Beautiful garden, gone, destroyed. And then, true, it was life went on. Life went on for Adam and Eve. But now death was a certain destination that seems to redefine life as nothing more than a utility. At least, that's how it seems. So, this is how we begin. Now, today we look at Revelation. Revelation is the end. And if this is how things begin by the third chapter of Genesis, then Revelation must be abysmal, must be awful, must be dark. Think of it. If this is how it begins, think of how it ends. And that's often the impression that people have of the book of Revelation, that it's a book about darkness and demons and destruction and apocalypse and all of these things that we might imagine. So today, we're going to go there. Today we're going to go to the very end of the very end. We're going to go to the last vision, the last chapters of Revelation to see the end. Get ready, cover your eyes, it's awful. Except, it's not. Look at that text that we've read today. Is it full of darkness? Is it full of demons? Is it full of destruction and evil? Does it sound a lot like what was left behind in Genesis? You see, we think of Revelation as the end, just like we thought of Genesis as the beginning, but Genesis begins and then ends. And guess what? Revelation seems to be the end, but what is it actually? It is the beginning. Interesting. To see the pattern that our Lord has set for us in his word. It's true that there is an ending here in Revelation, in this vision that John received and by inspiration brought to us. But what is ending here? What's ending is hatred. What's ending is death and pain. What's ending is disharmony and lies. What's ending is the rule of Satan and the definition of death. Because here in Revelation 22, we're back at the garden. And not just to look at it in sorrow from a distance and say, what was lost? Oh, what was lost? Imagine Adam having to live 900 years going, oh, what was lost? Fluid. Where I was and where I am now. Yeah, this is a story about where we are and where we will be. And it's not a sad story. It's the story of the ending of all that is wrong with the world. Very simply stated, in the third verse, there will no longer be any curse. Gone. Erased. Taken away. What Adam and Eve accomplished by their disobedience was a curse on their life, on their soul, and on all of creation. And the curse we see removed. And what begins here? Life as God intended it to be from the start. Because Jesus didn't come here as a great teacher to show us how to improve our life. He didn't come here as a social justice warrior to make this world a better place. Jesus came to reverse the curse. Jesus came to take us back to the garden. Boy, what do we see here in this picture? It's a beautiful sight, isn't it? As Revelation brings us back to the garden, what does it look like? There will no longer be any curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be in the city. His servants will worship him. They will see his face. His name will be on their foreheads. The servants will worship him. However, another place, the same phrase is repeated in Revelation, which says, the servants will worship him day and night in his temple. A picture of eternal worship. You're thinking, yes, you have long servants, but that sounds pretty bad. Eternal worship. I was knowing how my kids kind of cringe at that like the chief cactus. What does that mean? Unfortunately, our concept of worship is tying in with life in this world, fallen souls that approach God in life for worship as an escape. We put on pause the rest of our life, like we're doing right now. There's other things you could be doing today, but you put that on pause to come here and sit at the foot of the Lord and receive the blessings through the means of grace that He's given to us in the gospel, and that's a good thing. That is worship. In a broken land where we're dealing with people who have to live their life through the eyes of faith. But when we go back to the garden, it's a whole different thing. It's not a pause from life where we go and do something else. Worship is life. It is the very thing that defines our existence in heaven. It is the perfection in our connection with the Lord and in our reflection of who He is in our life. Let's start with the connection. The angel showed me the river of the water of life, which is as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and the Lamb. In the middle of the city street, on each side of the river, was the tree of life that yielded 12 kinds of fruit. The tree yields its fruit every month, and its leaves are for the healing of the nations. What a beautiful picture. It says here, they will see his face. Imagine that. There will no longer be any night or need for a lamplight or sunlight, because the Lord God will shine on them. You see, the original garden had a tree and a river. They were life. Life flowed in the garden. But man was cut off from that tree, off from that river, off from life. But here in this sinful world, we continue to walk apart from all of that until we leave this world. God sustains our life not through a tree or a And that life that we have is faith. We see and we partake in the great and glorious work of the Lord, but only by faith, by eyes that are given to us that are not our own eyes. They are borrowed. It is through Christ that we see God. But when we're back in the garden, that connection is restored again. We're not living from a distance. We're not looking through the eyes of Christ. With our own eyes, we see the Lord. We stand in His presence. We are aware of His presence. We walk in a world that is perfection. Because the Lord's perfect presence is unaltered, undiminished, in every way, standing in His perfect glory with nothing. Nothing that gets in the way. What a gorgeous picture of that connection restored. There's nothing here to Him, His glory, nothing, no need for faith anymore, because our eyes, we see Him as He is, with our own eyes, as Job had looked forward to in his famous statement about the resurrection. But what about this worship thing? What exactly is the description here? It's returning to the image of God, isn't it? That's how man stood in the garden to begin with. He stood as the image of God, Adam and Eve. Unlike anything else that God created, from the grandeur of the features on earth to the cosmos and the great galaxies and planets, stars, and all of the bodies of the earth, of all the beautiful creatures that He made the earth, there's only one creature that bore the image of God. It's us. There's something that we lost. But the image of God is simply this, that we would be identical to Him. We would be perfect, small-scale reflections of our amazing God. Do you see where we're going with what worship is? It's returning to life with the image of God restored, and you become, again, a perfect reflection of God. Or whether you're picking apples or walking by the river or having a conversation with a friend, in all of that, you are reflecting God. Selfless, it's holy, and it's beautiful. This is what worship in heaven is. It's existing as God intended us to be, free, holy, and perfect. Perfect, dedicated reflection of God, where our entire existence reflects and brings to glory. Can you imagine anything better than that? To have a better purpose, to have better energy, to have better relationship, to be exactly what God intended you to be. That's what worship in heaven consists of. To know its owners, to know it can't be taken away, to know that we can never lose what Christ has accomplished. In a few weeks, we will be at the foot of the cross. On Good Friday, we will hear Jesus say, "Finished." But Jesus redefines what "finished" means 2 days later on Easter Sunday as He marches out of the grave. Because what is finished is the guilt of sin. What is finished are the accusations of the devil. What is finished is the grip of the grave. And so as Jesus finishes, it all begins. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing in Christ that you have found in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We join now with the rest of our Christian faith in the words of the 19th century. countless blessings which we receive from your hand, the beauties of creation and the bounties of the earth, the joy of life and the pleasure of friendship, the good of work and the gift of rest, the privilege to share happiness and sorrow with one another. Above all, we praise and thank you for your saving word and for your Son's body and blood, which you give us to eat and drink in the sacrament. Through these means of grace, you send the Holy Spirit into our hearts and unite us to Jesus and to the whole Christian Church on earth. Great God and Lord, without your continuing help, we easily waver in our faith, lose courage, and grow fearless in our watchfulness. The times and days are perilous. Give us strength to face the evils of each day with fresh confidence. Open our lips to speak of your grace and move us to use the gifts that you give us to share your word of salvation with all people. Protect and prosper the family, the school, the government, and all good institutions that you have established for the benefit of society. Remember in mercy those who are sick and suffering, and bring your healing to troubled bones and lives.
We must pray for those who need and to help them with these kindness.
Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you blessed our fellow believers, Abel Post and Jerry Shade, who have now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought both of them to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort their families and all who mourn their deaths with your precious promises. Cheer them with the sure hope of blessed reunion in heaven. Grant the lifeless body rest, and at last, together with us all, grant us a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us to number our days so that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Hear us, Lord, as we bring your private petition. Now, eternal God and Father, keep us in the saving faith, and so enable us to overcome all things through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our
this in remembrance of me.
give thanks, give to them yourself, all of you drink of it. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
which hath praised thee here may glorify you in the world. That the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again. And that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.